So these are going to be my annotations from House of Earth and Blood, the first book in the Crescent City book. I meant to do this a long time ago. I didn't do it because I was lagging it. And after you guys know, after that one post from SJM, I was like, well, I gotta do my annotations video. I gotta show you guys what I wrote, what I highlighted. I gotta get through some of these annotations because I gotta refresh my memory on what happened in the first book a little. I remember what happens in the last 200 pages. I remember the romance vaguely, and I kind of remember what happened at the beginning. So let's get to it. So chapter 8 is where a book would normally start. So my brain just thought chapter 8 was like where a regular murder mystery would start, but SJM started this book a little bit earlier. If she tried to give us info naturally, by showing this book would be a lot longer and full of filler. This is what I said in my reviews, where if she tried to give us this information naturally, she would have done it in like multiple books, and it probably would have been like an 8-book series if she did this naturally, and there would have been a lot of filler, like in order to show concepts. A lot of the times, authors have to put their characters in situations. So that's why I wrote that. Info dumping to quickly immerse you in the world feels like getting dunked in cold water and somebody's trying to explain something scientific to you and you can't think straight. So basically, the idea for this was like somebody, you're jumping into a vat of cold water or a cool, or what is it called? Like a really cold pool. And then somebody tries to explain something scientific to you, and you're just like, I'm freezing. I can't think. I don't even know what's going on. I don't. I'm still thinking about the freezing part because it's like it's very much that when you get into this book, it's like, okay, so like what is happening? The inciting incident happens in chapter 5. Story gets the ball rolling in chapter 10 and 11. That's where like my entrance peaked. Someone made a video game into a movie slash book. Instead of doing the main mission, we're just fucking around and exploring the world. Open world game. So literally, it's like somebody wrote a video game into a book, and instead of us doing the main mission, we're just doing all the fucking side quests in order to get to the boss battle. And that's what I meant. Or like we're just fucking around and exploring the world, because that's literally what this book felt like. Like I did not hate it, but it took a minute. It took a minute. We were just exploring that world. Hunt and Bryce's relationship is slow burn and more effective than most book relationships I've read lately because you get to spend so much downtime with them. I would say yes, but in hindsight, there's one relationship that I like better, and that's the Butcher and the Blackbird relationship. And that one was more effective through page count and through like physicality and through like words. And I still think Hunt and Bryce's relationship for a slow burn is effective, especially for what they were going through and how they had to heal. But I feel like in hindsight now I have a number one couple up there. Most of SJM's books are extreme slow burn and give you the effect that you are living day by day with these people. Yeah, that is true. SJM takes her time to build all the relationships to get the most impact and connects you with the characters to the point where you are wishing for their success, safety, and love interest. I said this because I was like, I feel like someone's gonna die. And sure enough, you get to the ending, and we all know. Pages 200 to 379, learning more about the Red Rums and how they correlate to the ley lines in the world. Hunt and Bryce slowly falling for each other. Hunt and Bryce spend time together. And then this is another one. It's like the alternative to info dumping would have been like constant flashbacks of Danica and Bryce's relationship throughout the book, and I would not have been okay with that. And start the book with chapter 5, can't see this working. So like this was me trying to understand, like there's so much info dumping in this book, but there's like I was trying to figure out another way for this to work other than the 8-book series, and the only other way that this could have worked would have been the flashbacks, like constant flashbacks. And there were some flashbacks, but they weren't constant flashbacks in the way that I was thinking, where if they did this any other way, There'd be like nonstop flashbacks, like every other page, and that would kind of take you out of the story. So that wouldn't have worked. Alternative, longer book with focus scenarios and forced drama to explain everything you get in the first 100 pages. This is what I was saying earlier, where it's like an alternative to the info dumping would have been like a longer series with like forced drama, and you have to learn all these concepts and you have to actually get into the world building. I haven't even got into page one yet. This was everything in the front. Okay, Jezebel is a 400-year enchantress who had been born a witch and defected, had joined the House of Flame and Shadow, now answered to the Underkeen himself. Flame and Shadow suited her. She possessed an arsenal of spells to rival any sorcerer or necromancer in the darkest of houses. Look, if you're gonna put this, you're gonna put this in a book, I wanna see that shit. I wanna see this shit. I didn't even remember this when I was going through my read-through of Crescent City, but you know, now I wanna see this. I wanna see Jezebel like fucking shit up. Maybe I just didn't pay attention. But like, it would have been cool to have her in that final boss battle. Brace is half human. Danica's grandfather, the Prime Valbarian Wolves, and to Sabine, her mother, Danica usually wore leather jeans and whatever vintage t-shirt wasn't dirty. So Sabine is the Prime Apparent. The humans are being oppressed by Vanir and Asteri. Micah, Dominatus's face, the Archangel of Crescent City, head of the city. Each head controlled a specific part of the city. Prime of the Wolves in Moonwood, Fae, Autumn King, and Five Roses, the Underking in Bone Quarter, the Viper Queen in the Meat Market, the Oracle in the Old Square, and the River Queen, who was very rarely made an appearance, representing the House of Many Waters and her blue court far beneath the Istros River's turquoise surface. The humans in Blank Fields, because I cannot pronounce this, had no head, no seat at the table. Philip Briggs had found more than a few sympathizers because of it. The Umbra Mortis, Micah's personal assassin with the rare gift of lightning in his veins, could eliminate almost any enemy. So the Umbra Mortis is Hunt's. Rune is Bryce's half brother. Danica, only non-immortal wolf, foreshadowing. In hand-to-hand combat, Briggs would never survive against Danica, but one of those bombs would change everything. If Danica had made the drop into immortality, she probably survived, but since she hadn't, since she was the only one of the pack of devils who hadn't yet done it, Bryce's mouth turned dry. "Be careful, I will," said Danica. The Arkesian amulets was what was protecting Bryce that entire time she hadn't made the drop. Ember is her mother. I don't know who her father is. I forgot about that. I put Bryce trained on how to use guns. I want to see Cassian, Azrael, Elayne, Nesta, Amren, Feyre, Mor, and Rhysand use guns. Not me naming everybody. Thank Kathona. I always heard Kathona in the audiobook and I was like, Kathona, Kathona. It sounds so weird. Okay, I didn't remember this, and this is a lot. Jutting out of the quartz about 4 feet off the ground lay the dial pad, a solid gold block embedded with seven different gems, each for a different quarter of the city, the insignia of each district etched beneath it. Emerald and rose for Five Roses, opal and a pair of wings for the CBD, ruby and a heart for the Old Square, sapphire and an old oak tree for Moonwood, amethyst and a human hand for Asophodel Fields, or no, Asophodel Meadows, tiger's eye and a serpent for the meat market, and an onyx so black it gobbled the light, and a set of skull and crossbones for the bone quarter. I did not remember this. I ran out of time and I'm only on page 20. I'll be back.